right, if you have your Bibles with you, open up to John chapter 3. I love this series that we're in where we just get to take a dive into the person of Jesus, right, and go simply Jesus. And all summer long, we're going to be looking at this Jesus character that if you've been around the church for any period of time, like whether this is kind of maybe your first time checking it out or around the church, or maybe you're like an OG church person. I grew up, like, I felt like I was born into the church. My dad was a pastor and then my parents were missionaries. And then I went to like the private Christian school. I had chapel once a week and then I went to Bible college. And so I felt like I was like swimming in the waters of church, like quite a bit growing up. You know, the old adage, like one fish is swimming and he swims up to the other fish and he's like, "Hey, how's the water today?" And the other fish says, "What's water?" If it's what you're surrounded by all day, every day, like unless it's like a flying fish or one of those fish that comes up to the surface and like breaches, if you think about it, a fish wouldn't necessarily be aware of the fact that it's swimming in water because it doesn't know anything else. It doesn't know anything that's not water. And so one fish goes, "How's the water?" And the other fish goes, "What's water?" And so for me, a lot of my growing up, I've shared this with a lot of you sophomores, but for those of you freshmen that are getting to know 9-10 a little bit more and getting to know me a little bit more, I grew up in the church really believing that to be a Christian meant that you kind of lived this boring life. Right? I was an athlete in high school, and I remember looking at a lot of my athlete friends that seemed to be having a lot more fun than I was. Hey, they were partying or they were in these relationships. And I was like, man, I remember thinking like, if I wasn't a Christian, whew, the life that there is to be lived out there. And so I kind of bought into this lie that to be a Christian meant you lived a boring life, but you get heaven at the end of it. And I was kind of scared of going to hell. And so I was like, well, I guess I'll settle for a boring life now so that I get to go to heaven later. Because I believed that everybody that was having fun, like you got to have fun now, but you went to hell later. So I was like, well, if the option is heaven or hell, I guess I choose boring now. And it wasn't until I started diving into this book for myself and not just living off the fact that I was a pain. That's my last name, okay? Not P-A-I-N, but P-A-Y-N-E. Like I'm the youngest of four kids. My parents were Christians. My older siblings were Christians. I just went, I guess this is just what you do. And it wasn't until I started looking into this and started reading more about this Jesus character and understanding more that this Jesus wasn't just a part of like a school that I was attending. He wasn't just this thing that like we look to on Sundays. It wasn't just like this ethereal Jesus that's kind of this character out there. Or did any of you go to Sunday school, right? Or like Awana or anything? The like coloring book Jesus, or the Jesus with like the sash, the red sash and the lamb. And you're like, oh, Jesus, right? Or how about this Jesus? This one, okay? This Jesus, or how about this one? This Jesus. Hey, couple things, like this Jesus, if I look at this Jesus right here behind me, I don't really feel like this Jesus can help me all that much, right? Like he looks kind of soft. He looks like he'd get beat up. He's white for some reason. I don't really know why. I don't know when this photo was taken. I don't know when Jesus posed for this one. Right? Like I don't know. I just, there's something about this Jesus, like even the heart with the light and just the very neatly trimmed beard. Like that Jesus, I just look at this Jesus and I go, if I was invited into a relationship with this Jesus to give the entirety of my life over to this Jesus, kind of like, no thanks. It doesn't seem all that appealing to me. Like this Jesus, the bumper video that we had, it asked four questions in there. It said, where do I take my anxiety? Who can I give my insecurities to? Who can I trust in my doubts? What do I do on my darkest days? Where do I begin? It's asking these like big life questions. In a season, we have a 9-10 podcast. If you haven't checked it out, I encourage you to. You can even go back for the month of June. We talked about mental health. So we hit like suicidal ideation, depression, anxiety. What do we do with these really like gnarly things that in our cultural moment are very normal? I share a little bit of my story, my journey with anxiety. About a year ago, I hadn't really experienced much anxiety in my entire life. And about a year ago, I had this bout with it that it was a couple weeks of like really scary for me. And so I talk a little bit about that. I interview some of our counselors on there. But when it comes to Jesus, when it comes to the church, if this is your Jesus, no wonder when it comes to your insecurities, your doubts, your fears, maybe the depression that you're walking through, maybe brokenness in the world, when we look around us, if this is our hope, it kind of feels a little bit hopeless. And I think what I want to do today is, as we dive into John chapter 3, I really, really want us to take a look at who the Jesus of the Bible is. Right? Instead of reading the Bible like the Bible was written, I think we default to versions of Jesus. And maybe it's sometimes our own illusions of who that Jesus is, and he's soft sometimes. It's kind of like this ethereal, like floaty, spiritual, like he's got no dirt under his fingernails. He's just like this Jesus. And today I want to let the Bible speak for itself. Okay, I firmly believe that this is the greatest story ever told, that's hardly ever told in its entirety. More often than not, I think we pick and choose little pieces of this. And I want to dive into John chapter 3. And I love the book of John. If you're a part of our 910 Plus community, which meets on Wednesday nights, we're reading through the entire book of John this summer. And the beauty of the book of John is that he has one goal. He says, "Dear reader, I want you to know Jesus." He gives away his thesis. He says, "This is why I'm writing. I want you to know this Jesus." And so I would love to let the Bible speak for itself, because I think the Bible, the entire Bible, if you're taking notes, you can write this down. I think the entire Bible can be summed up like this. Three words: God with us. At our worst, in our worst, when we are most broken, God with us. When you read the Bible, when you start diving into the narrative of Scripture, you see a God that desires so deeply to be with us. He's not this ethereal, floaty, extra spiritual, no dirt under his fingernails God. He is a God. He is that desire to be with us so much that he sends Jesus. And then even in the person of Jesus, as you study him more and more, he's not like on a stage like teaching a message, and then he goes like back into this green room with air conditioning, and like people are lined up to see him, and he's just like, no, I'm just, please don't touch me. No, you see Jesus like he's in it. He's in the grime. He's at the weddings. He's with the prostitutes, right? Like he's in the gnarliest situations that you can find yourself in. And when you really, really study Jesus, you see the heart of God, that God desires to be with us. Hey, so a little bit of context of John chapter 3. We're going to pick up in verse 22 is where we're going to start. But a little bit of context, okay? John chapter 1, there's a guy named John the Baptist. Okay, so turn back to John chapter 1. Let me just read a couple verses about this guy named John the Baptist. So John the Baptist is different from the John that writes the book of John. Who wrote the book of John? John. Good. Easy question. Okay. Who didn't write the book of John, who's also named John? John the Baptist. Okay. How do we know John the Baptist didn't write the book of John? Spoiler alert, he gets his head cut off. When you get your head cut off, it's really hard to write the rest of the story. Okay. I'm not saying it's impossible. It's just extremely difficult. Okay. So John the Baptist doesn't write the story, but John writes about John. Does that make sense? It's kind of confusing, but John, the disciple, writes about John the Baptist. And here's what he says. Chapter 1, verse 6. I'm just going to like jump around and give you a little bit of context for who this John the Baptist is. "There was a man sent from God whose name was John the Baptist. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light who is Jesus, so that through Jesus, all might believe. John the Baptist himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light." Does that make sense? Anybody ever driven to Vegas before? You ever like driven? Okay, if you drive from here to Vegas, it's an extremely boring drive, like extremely. But then all of a sudden you start seeing like billboards and signs, and they get like more and more glamorous. And then if you, like right when you cross over from California into Nevada, there's like a little mini Vegas, It's like the first little town that has a bunch of casinos. It's got a big roller coaster. And if you've never been to Vegas before, you're like, is this it? Is this Las Vegas? And then when you get to Vegas, you can't miss it. Like, you cannot miss Las Vegas. It's like, if you think the little mini Vegas is Vegas, and then you get to actual Vegas, you go, oh, that was not Vegas. That just, like, pointed to. It's just you cross the border into Nevada, and gambling is legal. And so there's little casinos right there, like, literally right as you cross over. But then there's all these neon signs that are like, if you want to get to the Strip, it's this way. The Vegas downtown is this way. It's this way. So John the Baptist is saying about John the Baptist, he's like this flashing neon sign going, it's not about me, it's about what I'm pointing to. Make sense? Keep reading with me. Let's skip down to verse 19. Now, this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. Okay, this is John the Baptist. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, I am not the Messiah. Hey, Messiah is like a big fancy Jewish word that means promised one. It's the one that the entire Old Testament was pointing towards. They were all waiting for this deliverer. And so they're asking John the Baptist, are you him? And he confesses freely, I am not the Messiah. They asked him, then who are you? Are you Elijah? He said, I am not. Are you the prophet? He answered, no. Finally, they said, who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself? John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. Okay, if you want to read something later this week, Isaiah chapter 40, that's what he's quoting here. That's Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3. But if you go back to Isaiah chapter 40, read the entire chapter, and it's like a goosebumps chapter of a description of who God is, and then what he was desiring to do to show himself to his people. Remember what I said, the entire Bible can be summed up with these three words? What three words? God with us. Isaiah chapter 40 is like shouting God with us. Read it later this week. So John the Baptist says, I am not him. I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the ways of the Lord. Now the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, why then do you baptize if you're not the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet? I baptize with water, John replied, but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one after me, the straps of whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. John has a very clear understanding of who he is in light of who Jesus is. Okay, skip down with me to verse 35. The next day, John the Baptist was there again with two of whose disciples? Whose? John the Baptist, okay? So John the Baptist is there with John the Baptist's disciples. Okay, what does the word disciple mean? Learner, follower. There was this description oftentimes in like first century Judaism of a disciple that they would be covered in the dust of their rabbi's feet. Okay, rabbi means teacher. Okay, so if you're covered in the dust of somebody, what does it mean? You're following them very closely. Okay, ever been to the desert, like Ocotillo Wells, or like gone out and ridden dirt bikes? Or I remember the first time I went in like one of those big 4x4, what are they called? Razor, thank you. You know those like Razor things with the crazy suspension, they travel? Okay, if you're like a desert person, you know these things. The first time I went in one, I got out and I was just like, I had sunglasses on, I took my sunglasses on, I looked like a raccoon. I was just covered. Why? Because when you're following somebody else, you just get covered in their dust. So the description was, you're following your rabbi, your teacher so closely that their dust is literally on you. So these are John the Baptist's disciples. It was a very common term back then. It wasn't just Jesus who had disciples. Any teacher called these disciples to learn from them, to apprentice under them, to follow them, to learn their way of life. Make sense? Okay. So John the Baptist is with two of John the Baptist's disciples. When John the Baptist saw Jesus passing by, he said, look, the Lamb of God. When John the Baptist's two disciples heard him say this, they followed who? Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, what do you want? They said, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? Come and you will see. Hey, this would be like if you worked at Cane's and then Chick-fil-A got like put right next door. And then everybody like looked at Chick-fil-A and was like, clearly Chick-fil-A is better than Cane's. And then just like everybody left Cane's and went and worked for Chick-fil-A, and Cane's was like, it's fine. We admit it's better. Okay? If you're a Canes person here, I'm sorry, but you're wrong. Okay? But it, like, this moment baffles me. John the Baptist has two people that are closely apprenticing under him. Jesus comes along, and his disciples, they just leave John the Baptist and they go to Jesus. And John the Baptist goes, good. Good. Why? What does he know? He's a neon sign. He's the little town before the big town. I've never described Jesus as Vegas before. It's a weird analogy, okay? But do you see what I'm getting at, right? It's like we're pointing at something so much greater, so much bigger. There's no comparison here. Hey, read with me John chapter 3. Hey, and as we jump into this, because I'm a good pastor, I'm going to give you three words that all start with the same letter, right? Doesn't every great pastor do that? Okay, thank you. As we read this, hey, I want to read this text with this context. I believe there are three things we do with Jesus. We can either, number one, disregard Jesus. We can either, number two, downplay Jesus. And I'm going to talk about how we do that. Or number three, we can become disciples of Jesus. Hey, we can either disregard Jesus, we can either downplay Jesus, or we can become disciples of Jesus. Hey, read this with me. Starting in verse 22. Everybody there? All right. Chapter 3, verse 22. After this, Jesus and his disciples, whose disciples? Jesus's. Okay. Went out into the Judean countryside where he spent some time with them and baptized. Now John was also baptizing at Anon near Salim because there was plenty of water and people were coming and being baptized. This was before John was put in prison. An argument developed between some of John's disciples and a certain Jew over the matters of ceremonial washing. They came to John and said to him, Rabbi, that man who was with you on the other side of the Jordan, who are they referring to? Jesus, okay? That man who was with you on the other side of the Jordan, the one you testified about, look, he is baptizing and everybody is going to him. To this, John replied, a person can receive only what is given them from heaven. You yourselves can testify that I said, I am not the Messiah, but I'm sent ahead of him. Sorry. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. Underline that phrase. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine and is now complete. He must become greater, I must become less. Okay? There's kind of three characters in here. The first people are the people that just disregard Jesus entirely. Where is Jesus? Go back to verse 22. He's out in the Judean countryside. Okay, so there's plenty of people that aren't out in the Judean countryside. There's plenty of people that are just disregarding Jesus. And that's an option. As you go through life, you can disregard the fact that Jesus is a person claimed to be a savior, that there is an entire group of us that are following him, that have surrendered our lives to him, and you can go and you can just live your life disregarding Jesus. That is a possibility, okay? But more often than not, if you're here at church, you're probably not totally disregarding Jesus. Maybe there's a part of you that is, right? Maybe your parents force you to be here and you're just like putting your time in until you don't have to be here and you just sit through sermons and just go, la, 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 la. You can just you can go through all of JH78 and all of 910 and all of 1112 and just go, I'm just putting my time in. In the same way that you can go to a class at school and you can lean in and you get out of a class what you put into a class, or you can just do your thing. You can just go, I'm just here because I have to be here. I'm just doing ninth grade because I have to do ninth grade. I'm just doing church because I have to do church. That is an option, friends. I'm going to suggest that disregarding Jesus and trying to do life your own way will run out at some point in some way, shape, or form. Hey, Braden and I were kind of joking about how many leaders there are here today. There's like 30 students and 13 leaders. That's like a 2-to-1 ratio, okay? But if you look around in 910, like an Emma a JoJo, a Noah, a Caleb, a Vanessa, an Ashley, a Brayden, a Kyla, a Tracy, a Cece, a Hattie, a Maddie. That's fun. Okay. And all students over here. Okay. Like these leaders, the reason that they're here on a Sunday morning is because their life was changed by the person of Jesus. Maybe at some point they disregarded him. Maybe at some point they were just kind of going through the motions, but they're not paid to be here. Like they don't need more 14-year-old friends. Like that's not why they're here. Like they're here because their life was changed by the person of Jesus. So if you continue to disregard Jesus, my challenge is, and I'm not gonna like smash you over the head with a Bible, I am gonna try to, for 2 years, get your attention and go, hey, don't miss it, okay? I'm gonna be like a giant sign at all times, like really annoying in your face, like, hey, Jesus, and you're like, leave me alone. And I'm like, okay, but no, right? Like, if you're here, I'm gonna try to paint this picture of Jesus that is as enticing as possible. Why? Because he changed my life, changed everything about my life. So the first thing we can do is disregard him. Okay, and there are plenty of people that do that. The second thing we can do is downplay him. Okay, read verse 25 with me again. An argument developed between some of John's disciples and a certain Jew over the matter of ceremonial washing. They came to John. Okay, who is John to them? Rabbi. Right? They're disciples of John's. They're loyal to him. They're covered in his dust. They've been learning underneath him. Okay, so a certain argument developed between them over the matter of ceremonial washing. They came to John and they said to him, Rabbi, that man who was with you on the other side of the Jordan, who are they referring to? Jesus, okay? Now, have a little bit of grace for them. At this point, what has Jesus done miraculously in the story of John? Something. What's he done? Context of John. Oh, come on, somebody help me out. Good. He changed water to wine. Hey, he was at a wedding. They ran out of wine. He takes water. He turns it into wine. Right? If you come to 910 Plus this week, we're going to talk about that story. He takes water at a wedding, and there's this like deeper meaning to it. It wasn't just that Jesus was like, let's party, right? There was this deep meaning to why he did that. But that's really all he's done at this point in his ministry. He's brand new. So the disciples of John the Baptist are kind of like, who is this guy? They don't really know yet. And so they refer to Jesus, who we all now go, the most important figure that has ever walked the earth. They refer to Jesus as that man. That man over there, right? This is like at this point, it really is like a Cain's Chick-fil-A feud. You got disciples of John the Baptist, you got disciples of Jesus. And the disciples of John the Baptist are like, wait a second. We used to be the hottest show in town. Everybody was coming out to us. We had this whole movement going on. It's like sometimes it would be like the 9, 10, 11, 12. It'd be like 9, 10's got this thing that's like popping off, and then 11, 12 starts to pop off, and it's like, hey, we used to be cool. Why are they cool now? And it's like, ha, 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 we're cool now. Right? It's like this feud that exists between Jesus and John the Baptist. John the Baptist disciples are like, what the? That man over there, he's doing what we do, but there's people going to him. And so there's this feud that starts. Hey, here's a danger that I believe is more common in the church in 910 than completely disregarding Jesus. So I think most of you are here for a reason, but I think if we're not careful, we can downplay Jesus in two ways. Number one, we can downplay Jesus by over-spiritualizing Jesus. He can become like the picture that I showed you, like white Jesus. It's like this, it's got the heart and the peace sign. And we can just make him this like ethereal character that we like pray to every once in a while, that we check in with if things aren't going well. And that's about it. Right? He just becomes this spiritual aspect of our lives. But then the rest of our lives, like we just do us. Okay. So I think we can downplay Jesus by over-spiritualizing, number one, or what I like to call making him lunchable Jesus. Any of y'all ever have a lunchable before? Is that still a thing? Lunchables? I've seen them in the store, so another thing. When I was a kid, I got sent to school with a brown paper bag. Any brown paper bag people in here? Hey-o. Okay, brown paper bag, had my name on it usually. My mom would write like a little note on it. And then inside was usually like a peanut butter and jelly, like a smashed banana, typically. And then maybe, you know, I don't know, like a little Ziploc baggie of chips or something. Like never like a full bag of chips, like a Ziploc baggie from the Costco size chips that got put in the Ziploc baggie to save money. Okay, like that was my lunch. And then these kids would roll up with like the snack pack, like freaking puddings and like Lunchables, like make your own pizza. And I was like, Lunchables, right? Like, cool. Like, screw you, man. And I would like save up like a week's worth of lunch just to trade for one Lunchable. I'm like, you want five smashed bananas for your one Lunchable? World's worst trade. Hey, but Lunchables, when you open them up, it's the beautiful thing about a Lunchable is you like undo the top and then it's got all these little compartments. Right? You got like your Ritz crackers, your pizza sauce, your cheese, your pepperonis, and then there's like a little dessert compartment, right? It's like all in one little beautifully packaged spot. And if we're not careful, we can downplay Jesus by making him Lunchable Jesus. There's 168 hours in a week. And we can make Jesus, like maybe even we make him like the biggest container. You know, Jesus, you can have like this whole portion. I'll give you Sunday mornings and Sunday nights. That's how much I want to follow you. And you know what? I'll even sign up for 910 Plus. And I'll come on Wednesday nights. And then if I'm feeling like, if I'm really feeling it that week, I'll give you 15 minutes every morning, Jesus. As if Jesus is like, oh, you wouldn't. You would give me that much time? Right? When really, when you think about it, you know, if you came to a Sunday morning, 2 hours, Sunday night, 2 hours, Wednesday night, 2 hours, 15 minutes every morning, 15 times six is 30, 60, 90. That's like a little over an hour and a half. We'll just say you were extra spiritual that week, spent 2 hours of quiet time all week. That's 2, 4, 6, 8 hours. So you gave Jesus 8 hours in a week and 160 were for you. Which one of those is a greater number? Right? Like that's not a question. Hey, so when we Lunchable Jesus, we make him a portion of our life and we check in with the Jesus side of our life and then we go back to doing us. And then we check in with Jesus and then we go back to doing us. And we go, well, my dating relationships, my entertainment, my sports, my free time, my friendships, those are all me things. And then Jesus, but I'll still give you your time. If we're not careful, we can downplay him. And I love this analogy that John uses, and this is what I want to finish with. If we become disciples of Jesus, it starts not just with time, but with perspective. Okay? Not doesn't just start with how much time we give to Jesus. It starts with our perspective. Okay, he says this in the verse that I had you underline. It was verse 29. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. A friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine and is now complete. Okay? Okay, we're just going to do this because we have a little bit of time. Jojo and Emma, come up here. Okay? This may or may not be happening sometime soon. No, not Noah. Emma. Sorry, Jojo and Emma, come here. Okay? At some point down the road, this may or may not happen, okay, where Emma's standing here. I don't know, you'd probably stand here. And then Jojo, you'd be here, okay? And I've officiated a few weddings in my day, okay? So as the officiant, I'll be standing up here, and they're not engaged or anything, but I'm just saying, if this were to happen, like, down the road, this is what it would look like, okay? I would be standing here, and I would say, dearly beloved, we are gathered here today and blah, 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 blah. Who gives this woman to be married to this man? And her parents will be standing here and her dad will say, her mother and I, right? And we'll all be standing here and you will all be in attendance because you're all invited to their wedding, okay? Congratulations, I just invited you. Hey, weddings are super cheap, so it's fine. And I'll be standing here and we'll all marry them and blah, blah, blah. And who does Jojo have standing over here? A long line of?
The boys.
Groomsmen, okay? And Emma has a long line of bridesmaids, okay? Bridesmaids, groomsmen. You guys been to a wedding before? Anybody in here never been to a wedding? You never been to a wedding? You're invited, okay? I just invited you. Anybody else not been to a wedding? Okay, cool, 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 cool. Cool, okay, so this is a wedding. Congratulations, you just got invited. Groomsmen, bridesmaids, okay? I want you to just picture this for a second. Hey, Jojo, come here. Okay? I'm JoJo's best man. Hey, he invited me to be his best man, which a best man is usually the best friend. This is somebody who knows him well, somebody that's planned this day. I planned the bachelor party for him. Everything about this day has been me and him together. I'm psyching him up. I'm making sure his tie's straight. I'm bro, this is going to be nuts, blah, blah, blah. This is going to be so fun. We're talking all about it. Okay. And let's just say we're reversing this thing, and Emma and her bridesmaids are already standing up there. And because it's 2022, JoJo and Emma want to do things a little bit differently. And JoJo's going to walk down the aisle instead of Emma. Okay. And JoJo and I, we're walking down the aisle together, and they're like, here comes the groom. And everybody's standing, and JoJo looks super good, and we barely fit on this aisle together. And we get up here, and as the best man, I go to stand with Emma because I think I'm marrying Emma, and I think JoJo's the best man. How awkward is this moment for me, the best man, when I find out, oh, it's actually JoJo that's marrying Emma? Shoot. How awkward is this moment for me now? I thought I was getting married today. I thought this day was going to be one of the greatest days of my life. And then I find out that Emma wants to marry JoJo, not me. And I go, now I stand up here going, holy crap, I miscalculated this day so badly. And I now need to stand here while they get married and this is so uncomfortable. I'm sweaty. This is the worst day ever, right? It's the worst day ever. If you think you're getting married and you walk down the aisle and everybody there knows this is not about you. You're just the best man. You're not the groom. Hey, flip flop, reverse. Come back here, JoJo. If JoJo and I are walking down the aisle, there comes the groom, da, 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 and he looks amazing, and he goes up and he stands with Emma and they're getting married, and I'm the best man, and I'm just standing here and I'm like, how psyched am I for my dude as he gets married? I'm pumped, right? If you ever get the privilege of being a groomsman or a bridesmaid, it's the best. It's so fun because it's not about you. There's no pressure on you. No one's looking at you. No one cares. And whenever a groomsman do I look okay? It's bro, nobody cares. Nobody's looking at you all day, I promise. Nobody will look at you. So if you're the groomsman, you just go, great, this isn't about me. This is about them. Okay? You guys can sit down. Now read this in context, and this is where I want to close. Okay? The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him, and his joy is full when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine is now complete. Do you understand the analogy that John the Baptist is using here? He goes, I'm the best man. I get to point and say the bride is for the bridegroom and the bridegroom is for the bride. He says it's about Jesus. John the Baptist, when his disciples are going, dude, Jesus is baptizing over there. He goes, yeah, it's about him. This isn't my wedding. It's not about me. He uses the most amazing analogy ever. And then he closes like this. He says, he must become greater in verse 30. I must become less. He must become greater. I must become less. And here's where I want to give you a little bit of homework to do. This week, would y'all put yourselves, maybe even draw on a piece of paper, three categories: disregard, downplay, disciple. And then write your name down. Where do you find yourself right now? Do you find yourself just generally disregarding Jesus? Just going, eh. Do you find yourself during sermons just kind of checked out? Eh, whatever. I don't really care. Nothing really matters. One of the scariest things to me that I've seen in 9th and 10th graders post-COVID is just a really, really intense apathy. I don't really know and I don't really care. And it's not just I'm not just talking about 9-10, I'm talking about in general. But friends, apathy is a really scary downward spiral. And my that's not a judgmental statement, it's an invitation to maybe stop the apathetic downward spiral, and I'm inviting you in to the greatest adventure you could ever enter in on, which is a relationship with Jesus. But when it comes to that Jesus, are you disregarding him? Do you find yourself downplaying him consistently by either over-spiritualizing him or lunchabling him? Or are you a disciple of Jesus? And what's a disciple of Jesus? Great question. This is what we're going to unpack tonight. It's at 6:30. I would love to see you there. It's what we're going to unpack this Wednesday at 910 Plus. It's what we're unpacking over the next 2 years. What does it look like to have the dust of Jesus covering you as you become more and more aware? It's a perspective thing. Remember, it's not just a time thing. It's a perspective thing. As the best man walks down the aisle, as the maid of honor walks down the aisle, they know wholeheartedly, this is not about me. I'm here to celebrate because I know who it is about. If you consistently make your life about Jesus and create an awareness of him, I promise you, you'll watch that drip into every area of your life. It'll explode the Lunchable. You won't over-spiritualize him. He won't be white Jesus, right? He has dirt under his fingernails because he's willing to enter in, because the entire Bible can be summarized with this: God with us. Jesus desires to be with you, but he won't have a part of your life, and he won't be an over-spiritualized portion of it. He will be Lord or nothing at all. Make sense? Okay, pray with me. God, thank you for today. Thanks for the opportunity that we have to dive into your word and read just an awesome story like John chapter 3. God, I pray this week that we would be disciples. God, that we wouldn't downplay you, that we wouldn't disregard you, but we would be people that desire to learn, that lean in, and that want to follow. And we love you. It's your name we pray.